Namaste. I honor that in you which is also in me. That which connects us all, the collective, though we are all separate individuals. I commend those of you that are sensitive enough to really feel what's going on in the world at large. For those of us who don't have our heads stuck in the sand and are sensitive to the world around us, I'm speaking to you guys. It's a pleasure to be a speakerphone for the collective to connect with you all. And I thank you for being the souls that you are. Today is Saturday, August 13th. It's undoubtedly a very energized and poignant time. By the way, my name is Timothy Halloran. I am an astrologer. I offer to do both in-depth readings as well as mini readings that have a shorter turnaround time at the link below. And there's a lot happening at the end of 2016. You know, this is a period that at the beginning of 2017 we'll probably look back and we'll be a totally different person, because there is a lot that's happening. There is a lot of healing. There is a lot of digging up and turning over. And there's a very exciting, restless, provocative energy that is very much stirring us all at this time. So, I'm going to begin with the astrology. We'll talk about that, the actual planetary alignments as they fit into time and how this symbolically affects us in our life, being that we are all connected and as above, so below. And we have Jupiter opposite to Chiron. Jupiter is in a quincunx, 150-degree aspect to Uranus today. We also have Venus in a closing square with Saturn today. And Saturn is at 9 degrees Sagittarius, turning direct. So, first of all, we may want to begin with these planets that are not moving very much, because this is what affects us a lot on an individual level. So 9 degrees of the mutable signs, you want to check your own birth chart. Saturn will be aspecting these planets through the rest of the month. Uranus recently turned retrograde. He's still very much stationed at 23 degrees of Aries. So check the cardinal signs, 23 degrees. We can also see what is really being revolutionized by Uranus at this time. So the main archetypes that we're dealing with through the rest of this month is this Uranian Aquarius archetype. And we're going to talk very much about this full moon in Aquarius that's approaching on August 18th. We also have the Virgonian energy. Jupiter is finishing his nearly year-long transit of Virgo. We've got Mercury, Venus in Virgo. They're opposing Chiron these next couple weeks. And the Sun is going to move into Virgo on August 22nd. So we have this Virgonian energy, which is very much about focus, it's about refinement, it's about improvement, it's about polishing, it's about purification, it's about healing, it's about digging up and releasing and moving into more fluid, more pure, more functional, more functioning ways of being. So this is a very adjusting, refining, focusing time. Then we've got this full moon Aquarian energy, Uranus in conjunct Jupiter. This is an extreme restlessness that really provokes us to change things. And we very much feel this at this time, this restless energy. It's encouraging us to change our perspectives. And this is very much what I am hoping and praying for the collective and ourselves as individuals as well. I hope that by the end of this video, we will be changed. We will have a different way of seeing things. And by the end of this next month, or at least the next couple months, we will be changed. We're going into eclipse season in September. This is a very exciting time. So we're dealing with this Virgonian focus adjusting. We're also dealing with this Aquarian boundary pushing, reinventing, reconfiguring, blowing up and turning it over. And we're also dealing with a Sagittarian archetype, with Mars coming into a conjoinment with Saturn through the rest of this month in the sign of Sagittarius. So let's break it down a little further. We have Venus in a closing square with Saturn this weekend. It's going to form an opposition to Neptune tomorrow on Sunday. This is challenging us in our relationships. It is about maturing how we relate to others. And it's a time where we can take our relationship to others very seriously. And it can be heavy. Jupiter opposite to Chiron. This is a major healing transit. These next few weeks, they're very healing in the potential. But Chiron is a cathartic type of healing planet. I mean, it's shamanic. And all healing is truly shamanic. It involves the weaving in between the upper and lower worlds. And particularly with Chiron, there's a lot of the releasing. Releasing of the past, releasing of inadequacies, releasing of guilts, fears, etc. With this Venus square to Saturn, there can also be a feeling of isolation, being alone, on our own, misunderstood. This is a part of the Aquarian archetype as well, with our full moon in Aquarius, is an isolation. Nobody very much understands me. How can I connect to other people in a way that really respects my values? And the focus on values is going to remain there, as Venus forms a conjunction with the Moon's North Node on Tuesday, August 14th. This puts the focus on our values, on our relationships. Venus in the sign of Virgo is about refining these things, purifying these things, focusing on what we really value in a way that actually works for us in the world and for ourselves. It's healthy, it functions, it's practical, it's grounded. This is a lot of the focus with the Moon's North Node in Virgo, which is where our eclipses are going to be happening next month. September 1st, there will be a solar eclipse in Virgo. It's putting the focus on healing in this world, in our bodies, in a way that actually works. Jupiter opposite to Chiron is bringing up all of these past wounds and issues. You know, Jupiter being in the sign of Virgo, this can also have to do with guilt, shame, inadequacy, etc. This is the negative side of Virgo. Okay, so Chiron is in Pisces. We're still in the age of Pisces. We've been in the age of Pisces for 2,000 years. Before we get to the age of Aquarius, we need to clean up, clear out all of the negative Pisces potential before we move into a new, freshly born age. This is how this stuff works. It culminates, it builds up, it gets released. We still have to understand what's going wrong with the last 2,000 years in order to address these issues and heal them. Not only that, we've been in the sub-age of Virgo through the last 500 years, and this last 500 years, last several hundred years, have been when we've really started to collectively experience patterns of guilt, inadequacy in the major religions, which is Pisces. We've got Neptune forming a conjunction to the Moon's South Node in Pisces through the rest of this year. That conjunction will be exact in November. This is bringing up everything that is wrong with collective belief systems, which can be escapism, which can be blind faith, which can be passivity. Is that a word? Being passive, you know. Listening to other people, doing what we're told, not really having a backbone for ourselves, and just going with the flow in this majorly effed up world that is not looking out for us, that is not concerned about the well-being of the health of ourselves and the planet. We have to address reality, and these planets in Virgo is putting the focus on reality. Pisces is the dream, the ideal, the belief. Opposite sign Virgo is the reality. We are working with and healing along this polarity. We're clearing out the beliefs, the blind faith, and the acceptances that really keep us from accessing our soul's power. And the Aquarius energy that we're dealing with Jupiter in conjunct Uranus, with this full moon in Aquarius, August 18th, is the blowing up of these limitations, of these boundaries that have been placed upon us from the collective, from the past. It is about getting rid of the shame, rid of the guilt, rid of the inadequacies that are coming from beliefs or ways of perceiving ourselves that are not really true or helpful. This Venus square to Saturn, it's about doing relationship, doing our values in a way that works for us in this world. It's realistic, it's grounded, it's not waiting for something to come later. It's doing the work now. So we've got this Venus is going to be forming in opposition to Chiron at the end of the month on the 25th. In between then and now, Mercury is going to be forming in opposition to Chiron August 19th. This is about making us aware. Jupiter is our perception, our awareness of our wounds. And yes, we can experience this now. It is a cathartic feeling where we can feel our wounds. We can feel the sadness of the world, of the situation, of our past. It can be sort of bubbling up from the underworld, and it can be uncomfortable. It can cause us to sort of drift and you know, potential lethargy and these types of things. But I actually very much encourage us to get down with it. This is the Chiron way. If we want to heal this stuff, if we want to purge this stuff, if we want to move forward and access our own capability to be a healer and a source of positive change and transformation in the world, we have to get down with it, is Chiron. Go into the underworld, go into your wounds, and bring the light of Jupiter there. Illuminate it. Expand these situations. It's happening naturally, so let's get along with it. Let's go with the flow of nature. Why not? This is a wonderful time for healing. Hands-on healing, energy healing, talk therapy healing, psychological healing, any shape, form of healing. Let's get down with it. Let's do it now. Let's get through this stuff. Let's confront these outstanding issues that could have been going on our entire lives that we could have been misperceiving in the past. That we could have been doing the old sub-age of Virgo thing and cat-o'-nine-tailing ourselves in the back because we're doing something right or wrong according to the rules and regulations of the religions that's been handing down to us that doesn't actually have to do with why we feel so bad and why we're suffering and why things aren't moving forward. That can actually be a much more practical, much more just having to do with your energy, another person's energy, you know, this Venus-Saturn stuff, the Venus opposite Chiron. Yeah, relationships is a vehicle where a lot of this stuff can get brought up, and it's not fun always. But look, it may not be as personal. We may not be actually to blame as much as we've been led to believe, and we don't maybe just need to go pray for somebody else to fix it for us when we're totally capable of addressing and changing these things ourselves. And so the good news is that Mars is about to complete his several-month-long retrograde phase. You know, he's direct now, but he's still moving through his shadow phase, which means he's coming up to the point where he initially turned retrograde in April. At the same time, he's going to be completing a cycle with Saturn and passing Saturn at the end of the month on August 24th. Now, this is this majorly rite of passage type of period. I mean, I've talked with so many clients that the last several months there's been majorly struggles in terms of lack of energy, lethargy, not feeling motivated, not knowing where to put our energy. Everything's confusing, everything's murky. It just feels like we're treading water, and it feels like the life is just putting all these weights and all these pressures and then these limitations on us. Good news is that this has been a rite of passage. It's not punishment. It's not punishment. It's not that you're doing anything wrong. It's not that you need a cat of nine tails yourself any more than we already probably naturally do, unconsciously. This has been about us developing a totally new level of strength. And as Mars comes up to Saturn at the end of this month, we're going to be feeling it. Probably we can already start to feel this regained ambition, this regained strength. I mean, Mars Saturn, this is powerful, masculine energy. I'm going to do it now. Nothing's going to stop me. I got the ambition. I got the willpower. I got the practicality. I got the strength to do this. Nobody's going to stop me. This is my goal. This is where I'm going for. This is in the sign of Sagittarius. This is like, there's the mountain. I'm going to climb that. See at the top. You know, Sagittarius is our goals. It's our perspective. It's about orienting our willpower with our goals in a way that functions and works, and you can do it now. Do it. Go for it. Be it. The strength is there. The energy is there. You have been hauling ass in order to get there yourself. It's not been a punishment. It's not been something you've been doing wrong. This is the nature that we're moving through. This has been about us discovering a whole new level of strength, of capability, of power. Power. Do not be afraid of your power, my friends. Particularly you guys, those who don't have your head stuck in the sand. Don't be afraid of your power. Don't be afraid of your capability to initiate. Don't be afraid of your capability to revolutionize. and transform. And that brings us to this full moon in Aquarius. 5:30 a.m. Eastern Time, August 18th, 25 degrees Aquarius. This full moon is sextile to Uranus, conjoined with asteroid Pallas Athena, and in conjunct to Jupiter and Mercury. Oh boy, this is some powerful, restless, electrical energy surging through my body. I'm going to bust out of here. I'm going to break down type of energy. And I encourage you to harness this type of revolutionary energy. And so we're going to talk about Uranus. We're going to talk about Aquarius. Uranus is the Promethean archetype. He is the great awakener, the liberator, the third eye, who breaks down reality as we know it to liberate us into greater plateaus of reality that we never believed was possible in the past. Uranus is the future and the force that is provoking us to get there, being dissatisfied with where we are now. So, rule number one of what we don't need to feel bad about anymore is being dissatisfied where we are, okay? It's like there's many, many, many spiritual recommendations. They're very good. They have a point. And they may not be the be-all, end-all, one-size-fits-all truth of reality. Reality is way too complicated, way too mixed up, not black and white, that we can't always just all or nothing it with these one-liner spiritual teachings such as be here now. Yes, be here now. Be in the present moment. Get in connection with your true power as a soul. Get out of your mind, etc. This is the point of be here now. Be comfortable in your spiritual nature as it is, instead of being, you know, somewhere else that's just, you know, discombobulating yourself. And at the same time, if you're dissatisfied with what you experience here in this world, does that mean you're doing anything wrong? Absolutely not. Harness that energy of dissatisfaction, of restlessness, of, oh my God, I can't handle this, I've got to get out of here. Good. We need more of that, and we need more souls who are ready to be that, to challenge authority, to break rules, to bust out of the boundaries that have been placed upon us for thousands and thousands of years. The Sabian symbol for this full moon. A garage man is seen ready to test a battery. Okay, what does Dane Rudyard say about this cryptic symbol? It is our capacity of self to deliver spiritual power. Spiritual power. What are we talking about here is Aquarius. Spiritual power. Aquarius is evolution. Evolution. Everything's always improving. It's getting better. It always can get better because we're inventive pioneers as human beings. That we are. Why do we not have evolution integrated with spirituality? Is getting to the root issue of how our soul's power has been stripped away from us throughout the last several thousands of years, which has happened through authoritative organizations and religious organizations that departed belief systems that fundamentally make us feel bad about being the nature that we are by making life too black and white, and then we've only got to be white, we've only got to be good, we've only got to make the right decisions, which is what keeps us enslaved to looking up to authorities who hand us authoritative texts that limits our capacity to experiment and to break down what might be outdated and old and no longer works. And this is always happening. We're always pushing on boundaries. Stuff does continuously get outdated and does not work. And that does not disagree with religion or love or God at all. We need to evolve our collective beliefs to integrate evolution. And science needs to integrate spirituality, etc. Uranus in Aquarius rules astrology. What do you think this stuff fundamentally does, choicelessly, effortlessly? It integrates all this stuff together. Evolution is one with unconditional love. It means that there is always the opportunity through grace and mercy for, first of all, things to be okay the way they are, but they can get so much better. And so, I encourage you to be experimental during this time. And as we are dealing with the wounds of the past, the Virgo opposite to Chiron and Pisces stuff, we're dealing with these inadequacies, these fears, these guilts, coming out of what we're doing right or wrong or what we failed to do. And, you know, none of us are perfect. None of us are totally white. None of us are totally perfect. None of us are totally right, whatever that even means. We're human beings, which means what? We are a mixture of so many things. And to deny this is to deny ourselves, is to be inauthentic. And so what we see in many of these spiritual communities is, first of all, we go into these spiritual communities out of comfort because they oftentimes reflect to us our childhood situation. And I unfortunately see so many souls, oh yeah, we start to find ourselves in high school and college, and then we grow up, and then we get a job, and then we get a family, and we revert back to our family's situation, our family's beliefs, and we just do it the way we think we're supposed to. Same goes with the spiritual groups and organizations. We come into this group where everybody believes the same thing. There's a right way and a wrong way, and then we decide that we're doing things the right way. Yay! And so we fill ourselves up with this false delusion and false excitement, and we go, yay, I'm doing things the right way. And like tears of bliss and joy, you know, whatnot. And it's crazy. It really is. It's crazy. It's false security. Because that sense of bliss and happiness should not really come from us doing things the right way. It comes from us being the nature that we are, in connection with God, which is the nature that we are, etc. So unfortunately, when people start prescribing the right way or the wrong way, then it leads to sectarianism. And then we have all these religious fractions, cultural fractions, nation fractions. Xenophobia is at an all-time high in the world right now. It's a growing phenomenon. Fear of other races, religions, nations, cultures is a growing phenomenon. Holy crap. Because we're so afraid of the wrong way, and that's what everybody else is doing, because we've got the right way, we're ordained, and it's total horseshit. There is no one-size-fits-all reality, and this is where we start to lose our power. You know, we start to find our own way. Oh my gosh, I'm feeling good, I'm feeling connected, I'm doing good things in the world, I feel blissed out. And then we join a religious, spiritual group, etc., and they say, that's very nice and all, but if you're really serious about spirituality, this is a red flag whenever someone goes about it this way. Well, if you're really serious about this, well, you need to start following the prescriptions, the ordained rules, the authoritative patterns. You need to be sitting in meditation this many hours a day. Oh, well, it's not that many, you know, it's this many rounds of mala a day, and then you fast on these days, blah, 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 blah. And then we shut down and we say, oh my gosh, I thought I was doing it the right way. I'm not. Shucks. I'm not living up to standard. I'm not the japa master. I'm not the meditation master the way the teacher on the throne is. So now I start to feel inferior. I feel like I'm doing it wrong. And we shut ourselves down from our potential that we could naturally access if we didn't get deluded by authorities handing down beliefs that aren't true, that are not connected to nature. So here's the experiment, folks. Nature is a mixture of so many things that seems impossible to be together, we can't fathom it. Is reality. Is the truth. There is no one size fits all. No human being is going to have the same way of doing things than the next one. It's like training wheels when you're trying to do things that way, and it keeps us from limited from accessing our full power to go ahead. So here's the experiment. What rules and what regulations don't intuitively or make sense to you that does not comply with nature? Break them. Break the rules. Here's a spiritual practice that doesn't often get advocated. Break the frickin' rules. It's a spiritual practice. It is a spiritual practice. Because evolution is always taking us into the future. What may have worked 5,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago, may not totally relate to where we are in contemporary times. And that's not to say that they were wrong or that the teachers were wrong and that the point and the essence is still not here and true. It's that we take this essence, we harness it, and we evolve forward. Break rules that do not make sense with reality. It is a spiritual practice. And by breaking these rules, you will be liberating yourself out of the confines of guilt, of shame, and limitation that we've been living in the past, that there is a right way and a wrong way to do things, and if I do this one way, then I'm right, and if I do it the other way, I'm a failure. And so there's two ways that this unfortunate circumstance tends to go. Either we do everything by the book. I go to church every weekend. I do everything. I do not wear women's clothes. I do not eat pork. I do not do any of the, you know, things that the Old Testament says is just downright an abomination to God, right? So what happens when you go that route is extreme righteousness and what I like to call spiritual goody-goodiness, which is actually the denial of God and nature through doing what you think is right via man-made construction, okay? See it, hear it, get rid of it. The other way that is much more common for the demographic that I'm speaking to is shame, is inadequacy, that we're not perfect yet, and so we're doing something wrong. We're not happy all the time, the way the smiley guru on the throne is, so we must be doing something wrong, okay? Oh, we're not perfectly aligned with the teaching coming from the top authority. Oh, this is how it is done. Well, this is how energy looks like, and this is how energy healing is done, and this is how spirituality looks like, and this is how spirituality is done. This is how work in the world, this is how family, this is how gender roles, this is how relationship. Bullshit. It doesn't look the way one person in one prescription prescribes it, because nature is a mixture of so many unfathomable things coming together we can barely fathom it. And that's reality and that's the truth. And moving into the age of Aquarius is going to be about recognizing and celebrating that. The total potential of nature in all of its various forms coming together, recognizing that underneath it all, though everything, every conceivable thing is manifested, we still share this underlying truth that we are all interconnected. Though there is not one size fits all, we are all interconnected. There are underlying truths, there are underlying universal principles, but they are huge. They are wide open. God is love. That's what we're talking about here, all right? So there is this notion, it's old notions that we're getting rid of, old limiting beliefs, related to our wounds, related to our past, etc. This can be just like, oh, you have to do one practice in order to be a spiritual person. You need to choose a path. Choose a path. It's one of my least favorite things that I hear from people all the time is that, well, you gotta choose a path. And you know, there's that old quote that you gotta, if you wanna dig a well, you gotta sit in one place and dig and dig and dig and dig. And there, yes, there's a point to that, which is that you can't be so ADD, you can't just like flip a book and then think that you're gonna learn anything. Okay, we get that. Do not think that, oh, well, I have to do this one ritual, this one practice for the rest of my life. Otherwise, I'm not going to get anywhere, and I've been digging this hole, and I'm still not at the well. I guess I just got to keep digging. This is literally what the world tries to encourage us to do, which keeps us standing in one place and getting nowhere. We need to experiment. We need to break out of that. Nature is a mixture of things that are unfathomable. Guess what? You're not perfect. Which means that you don't always make the right decisions. And maybe instead of cat-o'-nine-tailing ourselves in the back forever, we should accept this as our nature. Here's why. It's so critically important. Because you're afraid of being bad, you're afraid of experimentation. Because you're afraid of experimentation, we can't access our truest power. Because there are these invisible lines drawn in the sand. And then we cut ourselves short. And so we need to break down these rules. If somebody says, oh, this is an esoteric subject and you must transcend through this level and this level by doing these rules and regulations before you'll get there. Or we do this to ourselves in our own way in life, through parents and authorities and all these sorts of things. Oh, I'm not up to standard yet. I'm not perfect yet because I haven't done this, that, or that. And maybe it's not because you've done that. Maybe it's because you have been frigidly looking at it from a limited perspective. And it's time to expand that perspective by experimenting and breaking down rules that do not agree with your heart. You don't need an authoritative person to explain to you what your heart says is true. Oh, well, it's impossible to know God, which is why we have to go through an authoritative figurehead, which is why that we can't challenge anything that they say, which is why I'm just a slave. I mean, that's literally the reality that we live on so many levels, it's not even funny. We don't just do this in religion. We do this through schools. Oh, there's the authority. There's the teacher. We do this through our work. Oh, there's the boss. Oh, there's the person who passed all the exams and has a shiny star, so they know the way. And if I'm not doing it their way, well, maybe someday I'll get there. And we never get there because we're not a cookie cutter version of that person. It's not a one size fits all reality. Don't be afraid of your power. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. Don't be afraid to be wrong. It's okay to be wrong. This whole good versus evil bullshit, it's not that it's not true and that that's not a part of nature. It's the way that we perceive these things has limited us. You know, the issue of the last 2,000 years, the Pisces age, it goes back to this Garden of Eden myth, you know, eating from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and, you know, this is the stuff that we're clearing out, is the idea of original sin. I've done something wrong to land myself in this position, and now I need to earn back my connection to God. No! 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 No, you don't! That's not what love is! God is love, right? We all can say this so easily, and then when it comes down to the down and dirty stuff where it starts to, like, good and evil start to get a little confusing and a little bit merged together, people are just like, nah, I'm only good, I'm only on the right side, and all the evil people, they're gonna burn in hell forever. No! No! We're all children of God. We're all souls. This does not comply with nature. But that fear of hell, that fear of evil, that fear of doing things the wrong way, it keeps us from accessing our total power. This is also the fear of, like, the Illuminati, and, oh, there's negative entities that are over you that you need to remove through some modality or another. Oh, goodness, there's this badness that's out there that's separate from me, that's possessing me and controlling me from the top down. No. No, there's not. There's not this going on. The only reason we believe this is because we haven't accessed our soul's power to easily transmute all this stuff in the blink of an eye. There's no authorities, there's no demons, there's no negative possessive beings that are clung on to you that you need to, shields up, clear myself out. Oh, I'm going into a negative location, so I've got a shield of armor and, you know, I'm gonna fight the demons, fight the bad guy, blah, blah, blah. This is what keeps us limited from our potential. By being afraid to be that which we already are, which is that you are good and evil. Just get over it. It's part of us being a soul. We have dual desires in the soul. Not 100% of everything that you do in life is about returning to God. That's all it means. Evil doesn't mean that you're killing people or hurting people. It just means anything that is a separating desire from God. I want an ice cream cone. It's not really a spiritual thing. You know, there's even ways of tantra. You can eat an ice cream cone for God. I'm not saying this is not possible. What I'm saying is likely is we do all this shit spontaneously, and it may be quote-unquote selfish, and then we cat a nine tails ourselves for it when we just need to understand that it's okay. It's okay to have dual desires. It's okay not to be completely perfect the way you are. Start there. Start by accepting the way you are. And if things aren't working again and again and again because we're trying to do it the right way, the right way, the right way, the right way, do it the wrong way. Try it out. Try it out. Experiment for once. Do something crazy. Break a rule. It's a spiritual practice. Do something that's different, that's outside of the box, because life and nature is a mixture of things that seem impossible to mix together, and yet it is. Let's think of some striking examples. Just read the good Old Testament. The good Old Testament, yeah. If a man dresses in woman's clothing, he is considered an abomination to God. If women do anything that's remotely superior to men, they're an abomination to God. I mean, there are so many rules and regulations, not just in Christianity, not just in religion, in culture, in the world at large, that is total bullshit. It does not agree with nature, it does not agree with reality, but we just follow suit. This is what my culture does. This is what my father did. This is what my mother did. This is what is expected of me. This is what a relationship looks like. Oh, well, you get married, and then you stay in your home, and you're devoted to your spouse, and you don't ever change that dynamic, okay? And I'm not saying that devotion and monogamous relationship isn't a wonderful, beautiful thing, but it's not a one-size-fits-all reality, and you can't condemn people that are doing it differently and experimenting. All right, I think we're starting to collectively realize that you can't condemn people from being gay and bisexual. Like, oh, they sided with the devil at some point, or they're confused and made a mistake, and no, they didn't. They're just being honest about their nature that's more complicated and evolved than what you can conceive. And this is true on many, many levels. It's not just this level. It's true on many different levels. It's okay to do things differently. If you need to be really experimental in your relationship in order to be with the person that you love, do it. You know, it's like people end their relationships and end their love to another person because it's not fitting the cookie cutter that's been prescribed. Oh, well, a relationship is that we come together and there's never any disputes and it's just Disney prince and princess living in the castle. Hell no. Hell no. Relationship is what? It serves an evolutionary function. An evolutionary function. By the way, I get really passionate in these videos. It's not because I'm yelling at you. This is just how I am, and this is how I talk inside of myself all the time. So it's not personal. Just a little message to put out there. So, full moon in Aquarius, sextile to Uranus, in conjunct to Jupiter Mercury, we are having this restless, provoking, experimental nature that is provoking us to change the way we see things and the way we do things in the world. Having asteroid Athena moving back into Aquarius as of yesterday and conjoining this full moon just makes it that much more clear. Pallas Athena is like the Akashic record. She's like the library card that just intuitively, you know, checks out the information and wisdom that we need at the time, and we see it. We see it like it's in front of us. It's just there. In Aquarius, she's especially powerful. She's seeing the future. She's seeing how much better it could be done than it's being done now. That potential exists. It's clear. We can do it so much better. We could invent solutions that are different. We can create communities that are different. We can find organizations that are different. Venus is on the moon's north node next Tuesday. This is putting the focus on our values. What do you, as a unique individual, truly value? And how can we make it actually function in this world? If we're not getting that satisfaction from the relationships or the groups or the organizations that we've been hanging around, it's time to, Aquarius, blow that shit out of the water. Jeff Green calls Aquarius a grenade in a steel box, and the steel box is Saturn, Capricorn, the authority, the system, the structure, the culture, the traditions. Blow it up. Push on the boundaries. Push the envelope. Invent and pioneer, and we will be expanding what is possible to be able to access our highest potentials as souls, to be inventors in this world, to bridge this world and its suffering with another dimension that is more pure, that is more connected, that respects one another as human beings for all being different, and it's okay. Even to the extreme of somebody messes up and does something really heinous, it doesn't mean that they are a forgotten, damned, possessed by demons, sold their soul to the devil. Soul! Get rid of those notions. Those fearful notions and beliefs keep us in prison, keep us afraid from experimentation. And then we don't access the fullest potential that we are. You know? I love to break rules. It's a powerful thing of what I do, but it's isolating sometimes, and people really don't like it. But it's important to do. I mean, I'm sitting on a freaking gravestone while I'm doing this video, a decapitated gravestone. That's just how it is. The name of this channel is Rasa Leela Healing. The Rasa Leela dance goes back to a spiritual story, and from the group and the organization that circulates this story, they will tell you, do not tell anybody about this story. Don't label your YouTube channel this, because it's too esoteric for you to understand. The divine dance with God is too esoteric for us to understand. The fact that everything in reality is actually a part of this divine dance with God, the fact that everything that we do in life is actually a part of this divine dance with God, that's too esoteric for us to know or to discuss about. We just have to leave it in the off, you know, limit zone. It's not allowed. What is happening as a result of this? We're disconnected. We're disconnected from our potential. Wouldn't it be liberating to know that everything is a divine dance with God? So even if you make a bunch of horrible mistakes and fall on your face, like Lucifer getting kicked out of heaven down to hell, is still a child of God, is still totally capable of being forgiven, is still someone who deserves to be redeemed, and so do we. So don't be afraid to push on boundaries. Don't even be afraid of hell. Hell isn't what it's been defined. Hell is the place that we go to transform, to improve, to have all the bullshit and the distractions and the ignorance shred away. So as we, Chiron, weave in between the lower and the upper realms, we are healing. We are getting rid of the junk, purging it up, so that way we create more space, more flexibility, more room to be the authentic individual that we are. So that way we can take ourselves and the rest of the world with us into higher dimensions of what is possible on this earth as human beings. So, get down with it. Uranus in Aquarius is astrology. This makes you all sorcerers, according to many people. And just even pushing the envelope on that, I'm telling you to accept that you are sorcerers. Because guess what? The word witch, sorcerer, all these words have been damned and they're not actually what it means. To be a sorcerer means that you are someone capable of changing your life and changing the reality that is around you. So be the uplifting, the positive, the inspiring warriors that we are. Mars coming up to Saturn. We've got this strength, we've got this maturity on a whole new level than we've ever had it before. So seize the day, my friends. I would more than anything love to connect with you all. I do offer my astrology readings in person. They're not quite as loud and direct as when I'm addressing the collective. Again, I want to make that point. When I'm addressing the collective, it's like the whole world is just like, come on, everybody, we got to do this. When I'm talking on an individual, personal level, it's more intimate. We're talking about your life, your past, what's healing, your purpose, your individual, not cookie cutter, evolutionary journey through life. Because it's not a one size fits all. So I look forward to connecting with you, whether it be in person, whether it be in the comments below, whether it be through the various groups, organizations that we're connecting to. I encourage you to join the New Paradigm community. We're getting astrologers together. We're getting the inventors, the pioneers, and the co-creators of the future together. So that way we can simultaneously realize how beautiful and unfathomable nature really is and get down with it and then create the new age, liberate us all. And then we all come together, all these different facets, all these different religions, all these different cultures, they meet uniformly, and we respect the differences, and we understand that we are all a part of one human family. And you are my brothers and sisters, and I am wishing you absolutely all the best in your continued endeavors. Namaste. I honor that in you, which is also in me.